called Graves into Gardens. And I wanted to just kind of give you a little insight on it, because I had a friend of mine say, you know, I really don't get those lyrics. And so this is what I heard the first time that I heard this song. When you take the line that says, graves into gardens, that means the things that in your life that are dark, the things that are buried deep inside, those hurts, those habits, those maybe horrible things. And God can take those graves, those darkness, and he can turn it into something beautiful and something alive and move it forward. And then when he sings the line that says, bones into armies, God can take those things that are the things that are forgotten in this life, the things that are just too difficult, and he can take that and turn it into an army and march it on towards a victory. Because, you know, God's armies always have the victory. And my favorite line in the song is, you can turn seas into highways. That means when you come up against that roadblock, when you come against that hurdle that's just too high, and you feel like, I just can't do it, it's too hard, God says, I can make a way when there is no way. And so when we turn the seas into highways, he's taking everything that we feel is impossible and making it possible. So, graves into gardens, everybody. I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. Men's empty graves and treasures to fade are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together.
You morning. How's everybody doing this morning? We are small, but we are mighty today, right? Yeah, I'm so glad to see all of you here, and we're thankful for what God is doing in our midst today. Even when we can't see it, we know that He is here and that He has good plans for us. So let's bow our heads in prayer. Father God, we thank You so much for Your love. We thank You that You can do the impossible. And Father, in our lives, there are many graves that need to be turned into gardens. And there are many seas that we would hope to turn into highways, Lord. And so we bring ourselves to You this morning, our needs, our concerns, our fears, also our joys and our victories. You are Lord of them all. And so we pray that You would be in our service today, that Your Holy Spirit would move among us, that You would strengthen and empower us to become the people You've called us to be. We love You, Lord. We give our worship to You this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right. Let's stand and worship Him.
Come by His Most worthy, you are holy. raise us. Your light will shine when all else fades. Our eyes will look on your glorious face, shining like the sun. Who is like you, God? You are holy, 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 God most high and God most worthy. You are holy, 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 Jesus, you are.
Jesus, you are.
worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Love to those.
Stand and know that you are around us. I love that line. It says, open my eyes and wonder. Let me see all that is beautiful and wonderful and glorious just around me. Help me lift my head up away from life, away from my phone, away from my troubles. And see how glorious and marvelous and wonderful you are. I love you, Lord. Be with us today. Help us understand the words that we are going to hear in the lesson. Let it come into our hearts and our minds and our lives. Not let it stay there. Let it grow. Father, it's in your name we pray. Say it in Jesus' name.
I needed that this morning. How about you? We've been talking about what it means to have a biblical worldview. And I think just with each unfolding week, it's more and more evidence that we don't all see the world the same way, right? Have you noticed that this week? And so I think it's important for us as Christians to know the proper lens through which we view the world and why. And that's why we've talked about some of these different issues. We know that God exists. We know what his nature is like, that he is powerful and all-knowing and loving at the same time. And we know that he created the world and everything in it. And that's really important for us to believe, right? Because what we understand about the world has a lot to do with where we think it came from. And it's important for us to know that we have a creator. And a creator who designed the world with a purpose to make it work a certain way. A creator who has sovereignty and authority over his work. And a creator who tells us that we should value things because he values them, including life, right? Well, today we're going to answer a question that I think hits a lot of people. And it definitely has a lot to do with how we see the world. And that is, what are we doing here? What are we here for? So we know that God created the world, and we know that he chose to put mankind upon it. But that question of why or what for really makes a big difference, doesn't it? What on earth are we here for? Well, what your worldview is would significantly answer that question differently. So people who are atheists or existentialists, they see humans as evolved biological machines. And so their reasoning or understanding of why humans exist might be left to individual interpretation. But most of them think that there is no clear reason. No really purpose. We just do because it just happened, right? It just evolved. Who knew? We're products of chance. According to the International Journal of Astrobiology, life is a very natural thing. which emerge simply to satisfy basic physical laws. Our purpose, so to speak, is to redistribute energy on the Earth, which is in between a huge potential energy difference caused by the hot sun and cold space. Woohoo! How's that sound for purpose? Your job, then, according to these astrophysicists, right, or astrobiologists, is to shift energy from one place to the next. I got that down. I don't know about you. That just seems ridiculous to me. Really? Life has to be about more than that, doesn't it? If you were a pantheist, which would include Hindus and Buddhists and New Agers, you would probably believe that there's no real value or purpose to the individual. You're just here to be a part of the collective. And so you might pursue knowledge and try to achieve higher levels of spirituality or Zen while you were here as a part of that collective. And you might even cycle through it one existence after the other, being enlightened as you go. But it's really not about you. If you were a postmodern, similarly, you might see the purpose of humanity as contributing to social justice or culture. Social justice is a new worldview that we have. But at the same time, you also might think that there's no one reality or truth. So whatever, right? If you don't think that there's any one truth, then you can't see any one purpose to mankind. So whatever you think is the purpose is right for you. That's your purpose. Polytheists might believe that we're here to be pawns of the gods that operate within the universe. And so they just manipulate us for their own entertainment. Or some might even believe that you could evolve into becoming a god yourself. Nihilist would say that there is no reason for existence, and so we might as well all die, right? And then there are deists, those people who believe that God exists, but who see his nature differently from us. They see God as someone who put the world into motion and then stood back, right? And so those people might think that it's just whatever happens is your purpose, or they might think whatever value you get out of life is what God had meant. So that's, you know, what that translates into, whatever makes you happy. That's your purpose. Be happy. All of those might seem silly to you. That last one seems pretty silly to me. But you know, I've encountered a lot of Christians who actually subscribe to that belief, that your purpose for being here on earth is to be happy. And if we're not careful, it sounds reasonable, doesn't it? These are the people who say things like, surely God wants me to be happy. Or God loves me, so whatever makes me happy is going to be okay with him, right? Very often that logic is used to try to gain approval of whatever thing it is that they want, even though they know it violates God's righteousness. So be careful, Christians, that you don't adopt that view of purpose that says life is all about what brings you happiness. Because the last I checked, the world does not revolve around you. And so you see, it's not easy to get people to agree on the purpose of our existence. But today, let me tell you what it is that the Bible tells us about why we are here. All right? To understand that, we have to go back to the beginning of God's Word. And you remember that Genesis tells us what we need to know about the existence of the world and our place in it. And if you look again at the 26th verse of chapter 1, it says, "Then God said, let us make human beings in our image to be like us. They will reign over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and the livestock and all the wild animals of the earth and the small animals that scurry along the ground." So why did he make humans? To be like us. Man was created in God's image. And that means that he created man with the same capacity that he has to love, to have relationship, the capacity for creativity and knowledge and understanding. God gave man the ability to have passion and to work for things that are good. He gave mankind souls that could live beyond the boundaries of their human bodies and into eternity. And so humans were not made to be God. We don't have the same level of all of those things as God, but we have that same nature that allows us to participate in relationship with him. And in that respect, we are reflections of who he is, the Imago Dei. And so one explanation of why we are here is to have relationship with God. And so we see that when God created man and he created his partner and then he said it was good and then he walked with them in the garden. Think about that for a minute. God walking with his creation in the garden. Why would he do that? Because he wanted to hang out with them, right? He wanted to have relationship with them. And we see that throughout the Bible. You see him pursuing a relationship with people. And so with Abraham and with Moses, God talked to them and had a relationship with them. And then he especially demonstrated that when he sent Jesus to the earth. Jesus was relational and he walked with people and he loved people and he touched them and he made a difference in their lives. And then in the greatest act of relationship ever known, Jesus died on the cross so that we could be reconciled to a holy God. Why would he do that? So that we could have relationship with God. So why do we exist? What are we here for? To be in relationship with our Creator. Does that mean that God created us because he was lonesome? I don't think so. Because did you hear him say what he said? Let us create man. God was there as a part of the Trinity, demonstrating relationship from the very beginning. And there was this word called koinonia that described what happened between the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The koinonia literally translated means circle dance. It's like you're moving together in relationship. And so while our God is one God, he has these three aspects that can enjoy relationship. So I don't think God created man because he was lonely. I think he created us because he knew it was good. And because he wanted to enjoy those relationships. And as soon as he created man, then he gave them a job to do, a purpose. And we find that in the 28th verse of Genesis 1. It says, God blessed them, and then he said, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and govern it. And so the second reason, the answer to that question of what are we here for, is to be fruitful. All right? Now think about it for a second, because at that point, being fruitful and multiplying in terms of procreating and having children would have been really important as a way to populate the earth, right? But as you read on in Scripture, you see different kinds of fruitfulness. And so to be fruitful is also to be productive, right? And we know that even being lazy is a sin, right? That God speaks out against it. He expects us to be fruitful, to be productive. And then if you take it the next step further, maybe you remember this chapter 5 of Galatians where Paul explains that to be fruitful is to be filled with the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, kindness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. These are the fruits of a relationship with the Holy Spirit. So when we talk about being fruitful, what does it mean? It means to be overflowing with these characteristics of God that come from Him. Oh man, wouldn't it be an amazing world to live in if everybody was overflowing in that kind of fruit? I think it would. I think that's one of our purposes in life, is to produce that kind of fruit. And you know what Jesus said? Well, here, let's talk about what John the Baptist said first. He said to the Pharisees, produce fruit in keeping with repentance. Right? That means that if you're sorry about your sin, that you can show it by your actions, right? And when you do that, the fruit of the Spirit comes in too, right? And then Jesus said, if you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit, right? So this is how we know this is part of our purpose, is to be fruitful. Because he went on to say that if you don't bear fruit, you will be cut off from the kingdom. That ought to wake somebody up, don't you think? You were not put on this planet to play video games. You were not put on this planet to engage in drama with all kinds of relationships you shouldn't be in, right? What were you here, put here for? To bear fruit. What kind of fruit? The fruit that comes from God. And how do you do it? By staying connected to Jesus. In John 15:8, Jesus said, when you produce much fruit, you are my true disciples. And this brings great glory to my Father. And in Matthew 5:16, he taught, in the same way, let your good deeds shine out for all to see, so that everyone will praise your heavenly Father. And so that brings us to the third answer. What on earth are we here for? It is to bring glory to our Creator. To bring glory to God. Did you know that when he knit you together in your mother's womb, he saw the future he had in mind for you? And it was to bring glory to him. Over and over again in Scripture, you will see that what we do is supposed to bring glory to him. Not to us, right? As a matter of fact, where's that verse that says, it's from Psalms 115, and it says, not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name goes all the glory for your unfailing love and faithfulness. Not to us. And so, whatever it is that we're doing, it shouldn't be about us. It should be about him. God doesn't want people to see his glory because he's arrogant. He wants people to see his glory so that they know and understand who he really is. That they understand the greatness and capacity of this amazing creator that we have. First Chronicles 16, 28 and 29 says, O nations of the world, recognize the Lord. Recognize that the Lord is glorious and strong. Give to the Lord the glory he deserves. Bring your offering and come into his presence. Worship the Lord in all his holy splendor. And you see, that's why we worship him. Not because we think that song is pretty, but because we stand in front of a glorious God. And when we see his glory, our natural response is to worship him. You know why? Because that's what he made us to do. Paul told the Corinthians, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. Whatever. And then he explained, you see, we don't go around preaching about ourselves. We preach that Jesus Christ is Lord. And we ourselves are your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, let there be light in the darkness, has made this light shine in our hearts so that we could know the glory of God that is seen in the face of Jesus Christ. And we now have this light shining in our hearts, but we ourselves are like fragile clay jars containing this great treasure. And this makes it clear that our great power is from God, not from ourselves. We were put on this earth to show the glory of the Creator whose image we reflect. I wonder how often we live our lives that way. And here's what I've been reflecting on. If our main purpose is to bring glory to God, how am I doing? How do we reflect his glory? We do that by developing his character and his fruit within us so that we become more and more like Christ, right? This is what happens when we truly love God and we love our neighbors as ourselves. This kind of sacrificial, truth-telling love is what shows people what God is really like. If you want to reflect his glory, you have to live like him so that people can see it, right? Jesus said that the world would know that we are his by our love for one another. And when we love people, they see God. By the way, you can't do that in isolation. You can't reflect God's love sitting at home on your couch all the time, right? You have to be in a community, which is one of the great purposes for God's church, is to come together so that that love can be lived out as a reflection of God so that it brings him glory, right? We also bring him glory when we serve. When we use the gifts and the talents and the abilities that he's given us in combination with each other in order to do great things. Do you remember Ephesians 2:10? For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which he planned in advance for us to do. Why? To bring him glory. It's his plan. You want to know God's plan for your life? It's to bring him glory. Romans 6:13 says to use your whole body as an instrument to do what is right for the glory of God. Do you see? This is why you were created, to be in relationship with God, to be fruitful, and to bring him glory. And maybe you were hoping that when we would talk about what your purpose is, it would be, should I be a bricklayer or an engineer or a chef? But your purpose is to bring God glory, right? And you can do that whether you are a bricklayer or an engineer or a chef, right? It matters not what vocation you step into. Wherever you are, you have an opportunity to bring glory to God. Even if you're retired or you're working from home, you have an opportunity to do all of those things for which you were created. Do you see? Because it's about what's in you. It's about that light that's there that is supposed to shine out from you wherever you go. And this is his call upon the Israelites from the very beginning. Do you remember? You will be my people and I will be your God. And the rest of the world will see me through you. And now that's us. We are here to show people what he looks like. And so a biblical worldview teaches us that we must do all of these things as we live our lives. How is that different from the other worldviews? It means we have different priorities. So the rest of the world might measure success differently than we do, right? And so for some, it might be about power or money. And for us, we're like, nothing, no power and no money in this world is like a drop in the bucket compared to what our Creator owns, because he owns it all, right? So it's just a false belief that you can be powerful. You can't, because true power is with him and those he chooses, right? And his power can work through us, but it won't look like what the world expects. We don't spend our time on the same things as people who have different worldviews, because we would rather invest in the eternal than the temporary. We want what God wants for our lives, not what we think might bring us pleasure in the moment, but what is for our best according to our Creator. You see, having a purpose makes all the difference in the world. And, you know, it really makes me sad. I have young friends that I see all the time who are struggling. They don't know what their purpose is, right? And they don't know what they're supposed to be doing, or they don't think it has any value. And the sad part about that is that if your purpose comes from you, it will disappoint, right? But if you know that your purpose is to bring God glory, then you can have the confidence to go and do whatever you want to do in His name. Right? Having a purpose gives us hope. It gives us something to wake up for every day. And these days, especially these days going through COVID, when I wake up in the morning, sometimes the first thing I think about is, what day is it? I don't always get it right either, right? What if the first thing we thought of in the morning is, how am I going to bring God glory today? This is the reason I get up, to glorify my Father in heaven. And you know what happens when you do that? It has consequences. It brings you peace. It brings you joy. You feel good when you go out and do something and God is glorified in the midst of it. So whether it's to stop on the side of the road and help someone change a spare tire, or to serve at Compassionate Hands, or to do an excellent job at work so that no one can find fault with what you did. You see, all of those things bring Him glory, and when they do, they bring you joy. Because there is no greater feeling in the world than stepping into what God has called you to do. If you don't know that, I hope that you have a chance to experience it. But it's not always about what we do. Sometimes it's about who we are. No wonder so many people around us are lost in depression and anxiety, because they don't know that God created them with a purpose. And they don't know that life could be so different. I'm so thankful that God gave us this window into what our lives are supposed to be about. And as I was studying this, I was remembering, do you remember that scripture where they came to Jesus and they said, why is this man blind? Is it because his mom sinned or his dad sinned, you know? And Jesus said, it's for this, so that God's power would be shown in him. Do you remember that? So there was a guy who probably thought he had no purpose, but God saw him and said, my glory is going to be shown in him. And you know what? I think God was glorified when that man was healed. But what occurs to me too is that he doesn't always show his glory the same way. And so for someone else who doesn't receive healing, maybe God's glory is shown in their perseverance and in their faith and their willingness to get up and have a purpose each day, regardless of the difficulties that they face. Do you know what? God is glorified in that. And this week especially, where we've seen people on different sides of issues and there's winning and losing going on and it's flipping and it's not flipping and I don't really know, but here's the thing I do know, that in winning sometimes we are glorifying God, right? Praise God. It went well. We did good, right? But there is also an opportunity to glorify God when it doesn't go well, right? Because sometimes when we fail, or when the things that we think we put our confidence in don't happen, that is the greatest opportunity for us to glorify God. Because that's when we say, I am not defined by the wins and losses in my life. I'm defined by who I am in God and whether or not I walk in His purpose. And that is a greater calling, isn't it? And so whether we are healed or not healed, we glorify God. And whether we win or whether we lose, we glorify God. Do you see? It's all for His glory. Either way, we praise Him. And we set out to be the fulfillment of the purpose He had for His people. That's you. I hope you feel that this morning. I hope you know how much you are loved by a God who wants to walk with you in the garden. A God who wants to make those seas into highways. And a God who wants to lift you up, you, like you are, and say, this is my creation, and it is a reflection of my glory. So we're going to go to Him this morning in a time of prayer. And I hope that you will ask God to reveal to you anything in you that needs to change in order to bring Him glory. Let's bow our heads. Father God, you are glorious. And we thank you, Lord, that you gave us life and purpose. And you give our lives meaning. And Father, there are so many times when we get off track on that, where we think the wrong things are important, when we chase after the things that we think will bring us status or pleasure, when really we should just be chasing after you. Forgive us, God. Pick our feet up out of the miry clay and put it on solid rock so that we might glorify you again. Jesus, we love you. We thank you for giving us the opportunity to be in relationship with God, for giving yourself so that that could happen. We ask that you would have your way with us. Give us the strength to praise you in the good days and the bad days. We love you and we know we are yours. In Jesus' name, amen.
So we pour out our praise, pour out.
So sometimes when I'm preaching topically like that, I'll look up a word in the Bible. So I'll go into the online and just put in a word and see what verses come up. So I did that with glory. And by the time I finished reading probably 30 or 40 of those verses, I was bawling. And I just want to tell you, if you need a reminder of who God is, look up his qualities that way in the word and see what it says. And it just overwhelms me sometimes that the things he wants us to know about him. And so I would encourage you to do that if you need a lift this week. All right. Don't forget that we will be here on Monday morning to pray for you guys. So if you have a need, please make sure we know about it. Better if you write it down, because if you tell me, I'll forget, okay? But anyway, or you can come join us at 9-ish on Monday mornings. Okay, closer to 9:30-ish, because I'm sleepy. So anyway, we're here and we're praying for you because we believe prayer matters. And so I hope you'll participate in that in some way. Also, on Wednesday night, our Bible Basics class is still meeting. This week will be on 1st and 2nd Corinthians. We're going to do those two together. So we invite you to show up here at 7 or join us on the Zoom call, or you can watch it later on YouTube. At the end of the month, our end of the month activity this time is going to be deck the halls. We're going to decorate the church together, and that will be on the last Wednesday night on the 25th. So I hope you guys will make plans to come. That'll just be fun. Many hands make the work light, right? And we'll have cocoa and cookies and Christmas music playing. So I hope you'll come help us get our building ready for the holiday season. Just a sidebar too, we'll be doing Advent readings. And so if you would like to be a part of that, please let me know. Otherwise, I might be asking you to participate in some way. All right. And then we are going to do Christmas caroling on the second Sunday of December for our scan pen pals that we have. We have 10, and I know we can't hit all of their homes, and a couple of them have actually moved into nursing facilities. So we would still like to bring gifts for them, and there's a sign-up sheet in the lobby. If you want to sign up, you can bring 10 candy bars or 10 cans of mixed nuts or something like that, and we'll put them into little boxes to take with us when we go Christmas caroling. Because the best way to spread Christmas cheer, does anybody know? Yes, is to is to sing out loud for all to hear. So that's what we're going to do. Also, last week we had a great meeting for Compassionate Hands volunteers. And so if you would like to be a part of that and you want to know more, you can see Pastor Elizabeth Ann. Also, there is training going on at Compassionate Hands this week on Monday and Tuesday evenings, and also on Saturday morning. There's information about that in your bulletin, so you can get the specific times or see Alan about that as well. So our church is going to be primarily doing registration, which is an everyday thing. So if you have an hour a week that you can give to help us with that, that would be great. Or they have other needs as well. So anyway, that is easier, I think, than staying here overnight. But it's also a very important need that we can fill. So please consider volunteering there. It's been a good day, hasn't it? Always a good day to be in God's house. If you have a tithe or offering this morning, please be sure to drop it in the bucket on your way out. And thank you so much for your faithfulness in all of that. Pastor, would you like to come and close us in prayer this morning?
Let's close in prayer before we leave. God, we just come before you one more time to thank you and praise your name, God. We are grateful and thankful and honored to be children of God. We thank you for what that means for us, for the ways that it impacts how we see the world and how we treat others. And God, I pray that as we continue on wherever we work or live or socialize or are in school, God, that we would remember to bring you glory, that is why we were here, why we are created. And God, I just ask that would be at the core of all that we do. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. My faith is-